Please subscribe and click on the bell icon for more videos.
Hi all. Today the topic of discussion is nothing new, but still I'll try to give a few positive insights on the topic. The topic is nothing but whether we need to support the fuel price hikes or increase in fuel price or not. Obviously, all of us know that we used to enjoy a lower fuel price. Not only we in India, across the globe, everyone used to enjoy a lower fuel price because a number of benefits, like you can drive all along, there is a higher possibility of bringing down the commodity prices so that the cost of living may be less. These are the perceptions on air. In this discussion, we are scrutinizing the claims that raised by various people from different corners and different aspects. Before we move further, we should have a clear picture of fuel pricing. For example, take the pricing of diesel. What are the components involved in the pricing of diesel? The first one is basic OMC cost calculation. OMC is nothing but oil marketing company. Some components like the crude oil price. Obviously, the crude oil price is much lower than 5 years back. Second one is refinery processing to convert the crude to diesel or petrol or any other hydrocarbon variants. Third one is refining margins, the refinery profits that involves, oil marketing company margins. Last one is freight cost logistics to transport the diesel or petrol from the refinery to the end point. The end point, naturally, it will be the dispensing stations or petrol bunks. So the basic OMC cost comes for diesel, it's 18.78 per liter. This is the cost of diesel and petrol on 6th of May at Delhi. This one I have taken just for example. So next component is central government taxes and dealer commissions. Central government tax mainly includes the excise duty and road cess. So the excise duty and road cess comes nearly 31.83 rupees per liter. The dealer commission, this is the commission goes to petrol pump dealers. Per liter, they are getting 2.52 rupees for diesel and 3.56 rupees for petrol. Why the dealer commission for petrol is higher? Sales volume is much higher for diesel when compared to petrol. Next component is the second level of taxation. That's a VAT, value added tax. Still the fuel is not comes under GST. Petrol, diesel, everything not yet been brought under GST domain. So the VAT of respective states will be levied. The total cost after adding the central government taxes and dealer commission will comes nearly 53.13 rupees. On that cost, the VAT will be added by the state governments. So the VAT percentage is 30% and that also will be added to this price. Final selling price at the dispensing station will come 69.89 rupees per liter. This is how the pricing of diesel and petrol has been done. We should note the point that as the central excise or central government cess is being increased, the percentage benefit for the state government on VAT also will be increased. So more revenue to the union government directly benefited to the state governments also. For example, if union government increase 1 rupee, 30% of that 1 rupee will also be reflected on the VAT. So that 30% will go as an additional income to the state governments. So price hike eventually gives benefits to both central government as well as for the state governments. Before we move forward, do you have any idea about the total tax collected by the central government in the last financial year? It's a whopping amount of 2.5 lakh crores. Obviously, it's a huge amount. Still, that's one major source of income for union government. Next, regarding the consumption of oil. What are the main consumers of oil? Petrol and diesel. As per the report submitted by Messrs. Nelson to PPAC, 30% of the diesel and 95% of the petrol is being consumed by private light motor vehicles. That includes cars, SUVs. So drop in fuel prices, both the diesel or petrol, that will give direct benefits to these class who owns private vehicle, whether that's car or sports utility vehicle, multi-utility vehicle or two-wheelers. Unlike 2 to 3 decades back, now a considerable amount of the petrol and diesel is being consumed by private vehicles. In the 80s, the consumption of the fuel, hydrocarbon fuels by trucks and public service vehicles. So that had direct impact on public spending, but now things has been changed. Here you can find 62% of the petrol has been consumed by the two-wheelers and 34% is being consumed by utility vehicles and cars. Only 4% is being consumed by the industry. So higher petrol price is not going to make any impact on common people's life. That will not have any ripples on commodity prices or public transports, because the consumption of cars and the two-wheelers are comes under the private vehicle spending. When it comes to industry, the pricing of the commodity and the profit margins also will be fixed according to the manufacturing cost. Let's move to the second part, that's the diesel price. Here you can find 34% of the diesel has been consumed by cars or utility vehicle. Then 28% is being consumed by trucks. That's a matter of concern. Agriculture, that's 13%. Same quantities by the industry also. Railway and bus altogether, more than 10%. So in the agriculture, 13%, you should keep one thing. More than 80% of the agriculture spending, diesel spending, is done on tractors. But statistics says that nearly 35% of the tractors are being used for construction and earth moving purposes. So the entire 13% cannot be accounted under agriculture. One third of it may be accounted under the infrastructure or earth moving purpose. When it comes to trucks, the logistic cost increases as diesel price increases, because majority of the goods movement has been done by trucks. But let's see what will be the end result. Whether the diesel price increase makes direct impact on commodity price or not. Let's a closer look on the statistics to get a better insight on whether diesel price hike results in a commodity price increase. Here I have compared the diesel price of Delhi, rice price on Delhi, and support price of paddy in a time span of 5 years, starting in 2015 and 20. In 2015 Jan, the diesel price in Delhi was 55 rupees 28 paise. When it comes to 2020 May, the diesel price has been increased to 69 rupees 39 paise as on May 6th. So the percentage change is 26%. When it comes to rice price has been increased by 4 rupees, from 31 rupees in 2015 to 35 rupees in 2020. Obviously nearly 13% hike. The support price of paddy will give a better outlook on the impact of diesel price on commodities, whether that has any direct correlation with the fuel price and commodity price considerably. Support price of paddy in 2015 was ₹1310 per quintal. That means for 100 kilograms, 13 rupees 10 paise per kilogram. And in 2020, it was 1,815 per quintal. So 18 rupees 15 paise per kilogram. So the percentage change is nearly 39% or 38.5% more specifically. Let's have a look on the bar diagram. Percentage gap between the rice and paddy is 25.6%. The paddy support price is to support the farmers. The price hike of rice is just 12.9%, nearly 13%, but the support price of paddy is 38.5%. So there is a considerable gap of 25.6% exists. The rice price has not been increased proportional to the paddy support price. So the gap of 25.6% need to be filled, and that will be filled by government subsidies. The only way to pump money as subsidies is to extract money from taxes, especially the taxes collecting from diesel and petrol. Please note that the funds needed to fill this gap cannot be earned by reducing the government spending. Reducing the government spending obviously will have a direct impact on the national economy as well as the employment scenario. That is another fact. Moreover, since we have a deficit budget, just reducing the spending will not be able to support this gap. From this data, I hope all of you got an idea that the commodity prices are not increasing as with the diesel price increases. Obviously, we know that petrol price doesn't have any role on commodity prices, because nearly 96% of the petrol has been consumed by private vehicles only. The only other way to find the fund for subsidies by the government is to increase other taxes. When government increases other tax, like if the government increases GST or any other cess, that will affect the entire population, irrespective of whether you are rich, whether you are middle class, or whether you are poor, or that will cause much adverse impact on the poor. Assume, on hypothetical grounds, if the diesel or petrol price reduced to half, for example, now the petrol price is something like 75 rupees. Assume that if the petrol price has been dropped down to 50% of the present value, to say it's 35 rupees or 37 rupees. Will it actually be a benefit to common people? Whether you are going to enjoy your life with that? Will it reduce the cost of living? Can you live with a lesser money and can save more? These are the questions. Unfortunately, the answer is a big no. On short-term basis as well as on long-term basis, the drop in fuel prices makes adverse repercussions on common man's life. Let's see how it will be. The first thing is, as I have told you earlier, if the diesel prices reduces to half, obviously the tax collections also will be reduced. Tax collection implies the tax collections by the central government as well as by the state government. So both the government's revenue will be impacted in a very bad way. Many states, after the alcohol sales, the majority of the revenue has been bought by the fuel sales. When it comes to numbers, already we told that 2.5 lakh crore rupees annually is being going to the central exchequers. So reducing half to the price, in a linear calculation or in simple ways you can say the tax collection also will be reduced to half. That means instead of 2.5 lakh crore rupees collection, it will drastically drop to 1.25 lakh crores collection. So obviously, as I told you earlier, the government subsidies, the government spending remains the same, or that should remain the same. If you want to enjoy a lower price or a steady price in the market, government need to pump money to the market in terms of subsidy. So if government need to pump that money as subsidy, the only option in front of the government is to increase the tax for all the services or the commodities that may or may not be essential. So effective rise in other taxes, that will be the direct result of reduction in fuel price. Second point, how it will be impacted negatively to the common public is, obviously as the tax collections reduces, government will try to reduce its spendings. The easiest way to reduce the spending is either put a halt on salary hikes of government employees or to reduce or stall the government hirings. In both the cases, that will have direct and indirect negative impacts on merchandisers, other businesses. Because never forget that governments, that means state governments or central government, are the paymaster for 4% of the country's population. So if they reduce their spendings, obviously that will impact negatively on entire merchandise, entire businesses, entire sales of the country. Hence their profits and the number of employment opportunities on private sector also will be reduced. It's a vicious cycle. Less salary, less spending. They will also try to cut down their expenditure. Again, less profit margins for the private business houses. Again, less hiring for private business houses. So that's a vicious cycle. That will not be good. This is the second adverse effect for the common public. You'll get a clear picture of it if I can explain that with an example. For example, if a fruit merchant in a local street, if the salary is fair enough for any of the class, his business will be very high. Naturally, when the salary comes down, or the incentives comes down, or the increments become ceased or deferred or delayed, the salary class obviously try to prioritize their spendings. In that case, if someone used to buy 1 kilogram of banana daily, they try to cut short their spendings on less essential things. So the people relying on that business will suffer. So government spending decreases. Obviously, that will have direct impact at the bottom level itself. I hope you are clear with that. Let's consider the third point, whether we can enjoy life with half the price of a petrol. So we are anticipating that when the petrol prices are very less, you can drive more, you can engine idling, run the AC because the petrol cost is very less. Let's do a fact check with assuming a scenario. Assume a family with 4 members and have a car. Say the car is running on an average of 700 kilometers in a month. Assume that the mileage of that car is 15 kilometers per liter. At the current levels of petrol price, per kilometer costs for earning will be almost 4.5 rupees. But if the petrol price reduced to half, that means 35 rupees per liter, then the cost per kilometer will come to 2.25 rupees. So the total savings for a month will be something like 1600 rupees for that family. But do you think that on other expenses, on the entire commodities that you are paying on GST will hedge with this 1600 rupees? Since government lost a massive income of 1.25 lakhs when you save 2.25 rupees per kilometer. So obviously, except petrol, rest for all the commodities, the price will be on the higher side. The tax component will be on the higher side. So the total savings for that month, when you accumulate the entire spending of that family, may be at least 20 to 25% more than the savings that incurs on the petrol spending. This is a simple scenario. I told this numbers just to make you understand the scenario. Next, we shall consider the long-term impacts. When we consider ourselves as a family of human beings in this world, what are the negative impact that you can anticipate by reducing the petrol cost? Obviously, the first thing is nothing but the excessive levels of pollution. Just like in Delhi, if the petrol price level drops down to half of the present value, obviously people will be hesitant to even turn off their engines of the cars. Even during summer season, people may prefer to sit in the car idling and run the AC. Eventually results in greater pollution. What's the result of more pollution? More spending on public health maintenance, more spending on family health. Third one is the electric vehicle technology will be no longer an attractive option because the hydrocarbon prices are cheaper. So there will be a drastic reduction on R&D investment for electric vehicle technology in our country. Again, we start to brood over an hydrocarbon powertrain system. Public transport also will not be no longer attractive. If two people are going by car may be economical. That also eventually makes more pollution. Unconventional, renewable, cleaner energy resources that all become uneconomical to tap by the public. We will not no longer be entertained with the solar panel installations or biogas plants or even with wind turbines. So the investments on unconventional, renewable and cleaner energy resources will also drastically come down. These all things will make a long-term impact on our society. Since hydrocarbon fossil fuels are cheaper, power generation companies, they also start to run diesel power plants. In India, a few of the diesel power plants has been stalled. They have stopped their operations just because of the fact that that is uneconomical. And the further funds has been diverted to install wind turbines and solar energy installations. That will not no longer happen if the fuel costs drastically came down. More number of thermal power stations will be installed. Enormous pollution that you can anticipate. That all things will make the life in this earth miserable. Not only for us, for our generations.
Now you may be thinking that whether these all things are new or not. These all numbers are new or not. No, of course not. These numbers are there in the system. These numbers are known to us in an isolated way. In news, in figures, whether that's in RBI data, whether that's in FCI, Food Corporation of India data, Statistical Department data, of any of the government agencies. All of them have this data and we used to come across this data often also. But that's in isolated way. In one news, you may have seen that the support price of paddy has been increased to this value. Today's rice price is this much thing. Today's petrol price is this much. Today's diesel price is this much. But unfortunately, we hardly had an attitude to think about it, and unfortunately, we failed to analyze it more critically. Moreover, we all love to go with perceptions, not with facts. But people who are wise enough, they told us some glimpses of the facts, like Dr. Manmohan Singh, renowned professor in economics, obviously our former prime minister in a couple of terms. He told in 2012 that much of the diesel is being used by bigger cars and SUVs owned by the rich and by factories and businesses. Should government run large fiscal deficits to subsidize them? That was the question. You too think about it. Do we need to protest against the fuel hike if that has little or a little effect on our daily life or daily spendings. Never go with perceptions. Go with facts. Think wise, think critically. Just want to wind up the session with an epilogue. As a nation, we should drive the system towards a cleaner energy domain. Unless we go with incentive or mandate-based schemes, this is not at all going to happen. What is this incentive or mandate-based scheme? Incentive-based scheme means some of you may be benefited with the CFL distribution and LED lamp distribution by the electricity boards at a subsidized rate. That's the incentive-based system. If you buy LEDs, we will give that for free. Government will subsidize it. Government will take some part of the price of it. Mandate-based driven, something like you should not sell incandescent lamps, filament lamps, because that consumes a lot of energy. In order to discourage the use of hydrocarbon-based fuels, fossil fuels, the easiest way to discourage hydrocarbon-based fossil fuels is to increase the tax. Just like we used to do that for alcohol and cigarettes. What you have done in alcohol and cigarettes? We have increased the tax in multiples. Just with the fact that some of the people cannot live with alcohol or cigarette, but still they can use it. But we are trying to discourage them by initiating more spending from them. Similar to that, if you can increase the tax, increase the levies, increase the cess on hydrocarbon-based fuels, more people will be driven to non-conventional and cleaner energy resources like solar panel installations, wind energy, biogas, etc. If not, we will remain as such with unhealthy practices. In short, the hydrocarbon resources should be kept expensive as a motivation to tap other renewable energy resources. For our future generations, let's join hands together. You may be thinking one thing in your mind. Irrespective of whether you accept the price hike or not, government policies remain unchanged. It's true, but you should keep one thing in your mind. Accepting the goodness and cooperating with that will make a lot of difference than keeping an ill feeling in your mind and suffering it. Let's join our hands together for a clean and green future.
Thanks for watching the videos. Please subscribe and click on the bell icon to get the updates on the latest videos.